there are so many people, the vast, vast majority, know nothing about the science of whitening. The way it started out, whitening was discovered by mistake. So no one really ever even bothered to learn the science of it. Truthfulness and ethics is very important to us. Otherwise, we wouldn't even be in the field. Having people virtually lying to what we would consider patients, but the general public, it's something that really rubs all of us the wrong way. Just like General Patton read Rommel's book, we as dental professionals, the more we learn about the problem and why it occurs, the more we can help our patients.
Get ready for your unofficial dental hygiene podcast. These are the tales of two hygienists, one East Coast RDH and one West Coast Guygenist. Listen as they tackle the profession of dental hygiene with humor and enthusiasm. Now, please join Michelle Strange and Andrew Johnston as they tell you a tale of two hygienists.
Welcome back, everyone, to another episode of A Tale of Two Hygienists, episode number 218. My name is Andrew.
And this is Michelle, and welcome to our podcast, all for the dental professional and medical professional, if you're feeling frisky and want to come join the dental side.
And also my dad.
Oh, I do love that your dad still listens. I don't even know. Yeah. I've been begging my mom to listen to at least 205, which is the vitamin D one, and I don't think she's done it yet.
Come on, Brenda.
I know, Brenda. You're killing me. They're like, oh, what's that thing you do? The radio thing? I'm like,
oh. The broadcast?
My family's super supportive, Avi.
Let me watch you on the old, I've watched your guys' podcast before, I swear.
Okay. Yeah, I hear that.
You sure have.
I mean, in some ways they could have, because they could be on YouTube. And
not much to see there, though.
I mean, they're just seeing the same screen, but they could be watching the waveform go through. I don't know. But anywho, if you're new to this podcast, we'd love for you to hit the subscribe button on your podcasting app and share it with your friends. This is a new discovery. Send us a little message or something. We'd love to hear about it. And we would always, always, always appreciate and enjoy your ratings and reviews, especially on iTunes. Go ahead and do that. Take a minute. We'd appreciate it.
We'll just wait right here for you. Go ahead. There'll be some silence, but that means you're supposed to be doing this.
Or you could just hit pause as long as you're not driving. I wanted to make this short and sweet because we have quite the lengthy interview today. It's going to be really great. Dr. Kirthi, he really had a lot of information for us regarding whitening. And, you know, y'all, my history's in perio and now I'm in public health, and whitening just ain't a thing that has been in my world other than my own teeth. I think occasionally you made some trays, but to say I knew all the things that I learned in this, I would be lying. So I'm really excited for you guys to hear it. Because it's lengthy, you may want to pause it and take a minute, take some notes, and then come back to it. I don't know. What are you thinking?
I am so excited for our listeners to be able to hear this interview.
All right. Well, enjoy this episode with Dr. Kirthi on whitening.
Hey, Michelle.
Yeah.
It's time for the interview.
Oh, but I had something else to say.
We need to let the experts talk now.
Fine. So listeners, I'm really excited to finally get this podcast going. We've kind of had some rescheduling issues here or there, but I've never actually learned the hardcore science behind whitening and bleaching. And so I'm really excited to bring on Dr. Rod Kirthi to go through all of that with us. Welcome to the podcast, Dr. Kirthi.
Thank you, Michelle. I'm very excited to be here.
Oh, this is our pleasure. Tell us a little bit about you.
Well, first, what I want to say is, you mentioned you haven't learned a lot about it, about whitening.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? Join the club, because very, very few people, whether they're dentists or hygienists or corporate companies, manufacturers, there are so many people, the vast, vast majority, know nothing about the science of whitening. The way it started out, whitening was discovered by mistake. So no one really ever even bothered to learn the science of it. But anyways, as far as myself, I graduated dental school in 1978. I did a very intense residency at Newark Beth Israel Medical Center after that, which was pretty much around the clock, very, very high in trauma, things like that. I loved doing dentistry, but when I finished my residency, quite frankly, I got bored. Residency was just, I mean, we were dealing with gunshots to the face. We were, name it. It was just very intense inner city medical center. I had been involved in research and development, when I was still in dental school. My first participation in clinical studies was in the field of perio in 1976, and my first involvement in a teeth whitening study was in 1977. What I decided to do is I worked, when I set up my practice, I worked Monday through Thursday. So Fridays were going to be my research day. And all of my nights and any time I needed on the weekends, I would devote to that. And this was all just for fun. So whenever a patient would come in and I was dissatisfied with the level of knowledge about their condition or products or techniques I felt were inadequate to treat certain situations, I set about researching. And, back then we didn't have the internet. So it was, driving over to Loma Linda or UCLA or USC dental schools and hitting the libraries and researching. And then I'd start messing around with clinical testing. And what I always did was if I came up with a basic idea of what I wanted to do, I would contact some companies out there. I have a method of researching that, sadly, I find somewhat unique. It should be mainstream. But I'll go back to a movie a number of years ago called Patton. And it was about General George Patton. Anyway, he did something in the movie that, as it turns out, was really true. He was one of the main commanders in World War II, and he was primarily a infantry and tank commander. Now, his arch rival was Erwin Rommel, who was a field marshal, which would be a five-star general, and tank commander. Now, Erwin Rommel had the Panzer tank, which could flatten the American Sherman tank. No comparison. And Rommel had written a book prior to the war when he was an instructor in the military academy in Germany. Well, anyway, when Rommel's forces met Patton's forces, the Germans should have kicked our behinds. But as it turned out, General Patton, his forces won. And in the movie, it showed him overlooking the battle area where he had just won. And he raised his arm and with his fist clenched, he said, "Rommel, you magnificent bastard, I read your book." So the point was that he knew what Rommel was going to do just by having read his book before Rommel even did it. Well, I think the same thing in research is so important. When you come across a problem, how can you fix that problem or come up unless you understand the problem itself in every detail? So that has always been my method of researching. First thing I want to do is I want to find out about the problem. Why does it occur? What is it about that problem that makes it so that our current methods or products don't work very well on it? So once you understand fully the science, once you understand all those factors, then you can try and figure out what to do with science to fix that situation. So that's been my method of going forward. And so what I've always done is I've contacted companies out there. And I've said, look, here's this problem. I think that I could create a technique or products or whatever, but I'm just a dentist. I don't have all the resources. I don't have the chemists. I don't have the laboratories. I don't have the money. So if you want to work with me on this, I'll do everything. You just have to give me the resources that I need. And when we're done, you own it. I don't want any part of it. I'm just doing this for fun and feeling good about it. So that's how I got started. The funny thing is that when I had a patient that had a horrible situation. I had done what's nowadays called as an extreme makeover on her mom. I'd done 20 veneers. And the mom said, hey, I have this daughter's 28 years old. She has healthy teeth. We had braces done on her, but they've got a really weird color that no one seems to be able to fix. So she said, I'd like to have you do the veneers on her like you did on me, and I'll pay for it. So the daughter had to drive an hour and a half to get there, but I looked at her, and she had this weird coloration of her teeth that the background color was about an A2, but about 60% of the surface color was these Hershey bar brown swirls through her teeth. It was some sort of dismineralization. To this day, I don't know really what it was. But, you know, I said to her, well, you know, I know that we can't whiten that color, but I'd like to whiten your teeth as much as possible. And she said, well, you know, other dentists have tried to do that and it didn't help. And I said, well, give me a couple weeks, because the more light I can in color I can get your teeth, the thinner I can make your veneers and the more translucent I can make your veneers, so they'll look better. So I said, give me 2 weeks. So I sat down and just went through all the science over and over and over again. And I came up with a particular technique, which I later called deep bleaching, which then now is known as core whitening. Anyway, we used that technique on her, and it took about 4 weeks. So when she came back for her final in-office whitening, she was a good 60% improved. It was like, wow, okay, this is great. So then we did the in-office whitening, the final. And when we were done, there was not a speck of brown. And her smile, she had a Hollywood white smile that was just absolutely gorgeous. And I like to tell, you know, a little story that's kind of a joke. It really is a joke, that everyone was in the operatory at the very end. Her mom had come with her. She was holding a mirror, looking at her own teeth. All my assistants were in there, the hygienist. My wife was in there. She was my office manager. And I went in there, and everybody was crying. Of course, I was crying because I just lost 20 veneers. And of course, that's the joke part of it. Anyway, at that point in time, my wife, she pulled me out into the hall and she got into my face and she put her finger almost up against my nose and she said, this one, you're not giving away. So that's kind of my background. I, you know, all the research and development, and I've written six different books for dentists, and I was the dentist for the men's United States World Cup soccer team. I've done a lot of media. I've done a lot of periodontal research in many, many fields. That's pretty much where I came from and how all this stuff kind of started.
Well, thank you for all of that. And that's pretty great. I mean, I think it's funny that your wife pulled you aside and was like, not doing this one for free.
Well, she's the money person. So
we all need some of those people in our lives.
You know, it's been so great because my entire career, I've been able to focus only on patient care. And I've never, ever had to think about the financial end of it because she takes care of that.
Nice. So you said that whitening was a mistake. What does that mean?
Well,
because one of my questions was, who invented this? And I guess it's not an invention.
This is a really interesting story. And I can't say that the answer to your question is absolutely positively true in everything that I'm going to tell you, but pretty much everyone in the industry agrees that how it started was this. Back when I was a kid, braces had the silver bands around all teeth, including the anteriors, with the brackets that held onto the wire, soldered to those. So when you'd smile, it was like you had railroad tracks.
Yeah.
But also because you had these brackets, these bands, these stainless steel bands wrapping around every tooth. And because teenagers notoriously don't take care of their teeth all that well, when you would deband an orthodontic patient back then, oh my God, the gums looked like hamburger. So edematous and red and just horrible. And so this study club of dentists were talking about that. They were saying, well, when these patients are debanded and they come back to us, what can we do to get their gums to heal up faster? one of the dentists in the study club said, well, there's that product on the market that's supposed to, you know, help gums heal called Glyoxide. It's still on the market today. And so this dentist said, well, what if we made some trays that covered the patient's teeth and covered their gums, and we had the patients put Glyoxide in there and wear those trays for a certain length of time every day, and we could see if the gums heal up more quickly, if they rebound back to health more quickly. Now, of course, the patients we're talking about are teenagers. We might get into this later, but I don't know if you or the audience is aware, anyone out there that's ever whitened the teeth of someone that's 14 to 16 years old has found that those teeth get really, really white really, really quick. They're very, very easy to whiten. So anyway, that's the age category here of the patients that we're talking about. So then when this group met again, someone said, hey, am I crazy or what? You know, have the rest of you been seeing what appears to be that teeth haven't gotten lighter in color from doing this? Now, I don't know whether they found any improvement in the gingival tissues, but yeah, they all agreed, wow, yeah, this gets the teeth whiter. So they started using it. And son of a gun, what is the primary ingredient in Glyoxide? It's 10% carbamide peroxide. That's what the active ingredient is. Of course, the corporate world got wind of this. And as you may remember, you know, very, very few people nowadays, very few dentists use 10% carbamide peroxide. It's usually 15 or greater percent. Very, very few use 10%. But all of it started out as 10% carbamide peroxide. Why? Not because they figured this is a good percentage, but that's because what Glyoxide was. And Glyoxide worked. So companies then started manufacturing products that had 10% carbamide peroxide, and they would put them in trays to whiten the teeth. Now, back then, the products were very, very runny. They were very, very watery. So what did we do? We actually put thin sheets of sponge over the facials of the models and then sucked down the trays over that so that you would drip this stuff into the sponges and then put it in the mouth. Well, of course, the effectiveness wasn't all that great. So back then, to get much of a result at all, to even be truly noticeable, you're talking 6 to 8 weeks of wearing those every day. So now, of course, you know, we are Americans. And, you know, the joke is we Americans, we stomp our fists and we say we want what we want and we want it now. So, you know, that's our culture. And so companies started thinking, well, you know, what are we going to do about this? The first thought was to make the gel stronger. Well, when they did that, of course, it burned the gums. So they thought, well, okay, why don't we bring them in the office and we'll put rubber dam so that it doesn't burn the gums and we'll put that on the teeth. But they saw very, very little. And actually, at that time, they were using what's the liquidy high concentration hydrogen peroxide? At any rate, that's what they used. And actually, this was back in the late 70s. What we would do and what we did in the first study that I was involved with is after putting the rubber dam on, we'd put gauze over the facials and we'd drip the high concentration hydrogen peroxide into the gauze. They just really didn't see a lot of result. And so they figured, well, we need to make this hydrogen peroxide break down faster. How do we do that? Some person said, hey, I remember when I was back in high school, we'd put a couple things in a little dish, you know, ingredients and nothing happened. But then we put it over a Bunsen burner to add heat energy and boom, the reaction would go. And of course, that's called an endothermic reaction. So why don't we see if we can heat up the gel? Well, so what was used is those, you know, those red bulbs, you know, the heating lamps, and to add heat energy to it to make it break down faster. Pretty much the results were that it didn't make any difference to the color of the teeth, but it killed pulps. Because we all know that pulpal vitality is very sensitive to temperature. Then someone said, well, what if we try photon energy, lights and lasers? Because that probably won't put as much heat in there, but yet it'll put light energy in there. And so that's when, you know, lights and lasers, bleaching lights and lasers was born. But of course, you know, now pretty much everybody on the planet in the dental industry is aware that bleaching lights and lasers don't work. Certainly companies still tout them, and they have studies that they have funded, of course, that prove it. But all the other studies out there, pretty almost all of them in the science, which, I mean, there's hundreds that were not financed, no research grants to universities from these whitening companies, they all show that the light doesn't work. And we should have known that all the time, because for those listeners that haven't really had much chemistry, there's two basic types of chemical reactions. The one that we normally think of is an endothermic reaction. Just like, you know, back in high school chemistry, like I said, you put a couple things in a dish, nothing happens, but when you add heat energy from a Bunsen burner, now the reaction goes. That's an endothermic reaction. So of course, you know, they were thinking, well, you know, we put energy into it and it should break down faster. But there's another kind of reaction that's called an exothermic reaction. And I think the two examples of that that we're all familiar with is hand warmers. You know, when we go up, you know, to the mountains and the snow, we have gloves and it's cold, and we buy these packets, and there's a packet inside a packet, and we crush it and we mix it. Well, when the chemical reaction happens, it gives off heat. The other example that everybody understands is when you pour up models with plaster or stone. As the stone or plaster sets, it gives off heat, right? So that's an exothermic reaction. So an endothermic reaction needs to have energy put into it to proceed. But an exothermic reaction needs to get rid of energy, most commonly in the form of heat, to be able to proceed. Well, guess what the breakdown of hydrogen peroxide is? It's exothermic. So why in the world would we think that trying to put light energy or heat energy or any energy into the reaction is going to make it go faster? In fact, according to Le Chatelier's principle of chemical equilibrium, if you try and force energy into an exothermic reaction that's trying to get rid of energy, you impair the breakdown of the reaction. Well, lights and lasers don't give off that much, you know, photon energy to really slow down the reaction, but they sure as heck don't help it. Anyway, this is how this all came around. And so now when they came up with, okay, we have this in-office whitening where you can have your patients in for 1 hour and use the light or the laser and they'll get white. Well, the bottom line is dentists and patients found out that was not true. Oh, maybe at the very end of the procedure, because of dehydration and other factors, the teeth might be temporarily a little lighter. Within a couple of days, they rehydrate. You know, the oxygen bubbles and the surface enamel, they're gone. And now they're right back or nearly back to where they were. And now you have an unhappy patient. Well, we dentists, many of us, most of us, I think, have no real business background. And so when a patient is aggravated, and let's call the patient right now a customer. So when our customer is unhappy, and especially if they're asking for a refund, oh, it bothered us so much for a couple reasons. Number one, from a business aspect, we've never been trained how to deal with unhappy customers. But even worse, we're health professionals and we are proud of what we do. And when we have a patient so upset that they're asking for a refund, emotionally, it is so difficult for us. We lose sleep over it. Well, we dental professionals, we're pretty smart. And we had already learned at this point in time that at-home whitening will get the teeth lighter. Not as white as we'd like and not as quickly as we'd like, but it'll work. So what did dentists start doing? And it was a dentist that did this, not the companies. Dentists started taking impressions and making trays. And after doing the in-office whitening, they'd send their patients home with trays. Why? Because they didn't want the patients to be upset, and they knew, and they figured, well, maybe the in-office whitening would be kind of a jump start. And that is, other than core whitening, that is where the entire industry is right now. This is all just throwing something against the wall to see what's going to stick. It has nothing whatsoever to do with learning the science and figuring it all out and figuring out the way science would want us to proceed to get genuinely great results. So that's how this all occurred. And a lot of people, when I say, hey, current day whitening has nothing to do with science, people laugh at me. They say, well, look at all the studies. Well, do you know what studies are in journals? For the most part, all research and development, the invention, the creation of techniques and products is 99%+ done by the corporate side of dentistry. Then we give it to universities and say, here, please do your studies so that we can show dentists that this stuff works, or, you know, that type of thing. Just because universities studied all of this stuff doesn't mean it came from science. I always feel that it's very funny, and you know, with my general patent type of thing, wanting to really learn the science, getting into the science of why we had the problems with whitening that we've had, that's what caused me to learn very detailed science about how whitening works and why we have problems, etc., which allowed me to then utilize science to figure out how science would allow it to truly work the way we want it to. So that's how all this stuff came about.
I have a feeling I know your answer, but I'm just curious about your thoughts and feelings about these pop-up whitening places, like in the mall and these little outlets, and you have like teenagers putting little whitening, I don't know, devices for people. It baffles me, but I'm just curious what your thoughts are.
Okay, well, there's a couple things that you just mentioned that are different topics, and they're very important. Let me talk about the most important one. You talked about teenagers and, you know, going to these little whitening, what do they call them, kiosks or whatever. But also, let's talk about teenagers using whitening strips, things like that. This is a big, and if I forget to come back to the kiosk thing, as far as I think what you're asking, remind me. But I think this is really important. First of all, it's difficult for me to talk about certain things and science when I haven't talked about all the science yet, because people won't understand what I'm talking about because I haven't talked about the rest of the science yet. So I'll do my best here. But hydrogen peroxide can break down in two different ways. It can break down to only molecular oxygen and water, but it can also break down to radicals and ions, such as perhydroxyl radicals, hydroxyl radicals, superoxide radicals, oxygen ions, and hydrogen ions. Now, what the heck are hydrogen ions? Well, you've heard of pH, right? pH relates to acid. Well, what does pH mean? It means potential of hydrogen. Hydrogen ions are acid, period. So when whitening gels break down, if they break down to oxygen and water, that does us no good. We're breathing air which has oxygen in it 24 hours a day, and our teeth aren't getting whiter. So molecular oxygen and water, they do nothing. So it's actually mainly the perhydroxyl radicals that whiten teeth. But when it's going to break down that method, it's going to give off hydrogen ions, which is acid. So you may have a whitening gel, for instance, that is manufactured neutral, but as it breaks down before you even get it, and then it breaks down more when it's on your teeth, it's giving off acid. It's becoming more and more acidic. Now, one of the two main chemical stabilizers that pretty much all companies other than us put in their whitening gels to stabilize them is phosphoric acid. Remember that whitening gels are unstable chemicals. That's a good thing. That's why when you put them in the mouth, they can break down quickly and whiten your teeth. But it's a double-edged sword, because the fact that they're so unstable, that if not under refrigeration, they start breaking down immediately on their own after manufacture. And then going through the horrible heat conditions, when they're in freight trucks, temperatures inside freight trucks get up to 165 degrees Fahrenheit. Then they go in UPS trucks, which are brown and all the heat. Then they're stored in warehouses that are certainly not air conditioned or refrigerated and often get very, very warm. So if you had no chemical stabilizer and you didn't refrigerate, by the time you'd receive it, it would be virtually spent. It would be all gone. It would have no effectiveness whatsoever. So these companies have to put these stabilizers in them. Now, keep in mind that over-the-counter types of products, oh, do they get abused? My goodness, they're in heated conditions, not refrigerated, like crazy, much more so than professional products that are dispensed in dental offices. So these over-the-counter preparations, like white strips, oh, man, they've got to load these things up with phosphoric acid to stabilize them. Yet, if they stabilize them too much, then, of course, they wouldn't work when you put them in the mouth. There's a balancing act there. So when the teenagers get these, they put them on their teeth, and their teeth get white. People will say, oh, gee, your teeth look white. So they want them whiter and whiter and whiter, and they want to be like neon. You know, that's how a lot of teenagers are. So they start abusing these OTC white strips. And that's the reason that you hear anecdotal comments out there about how badly some people's teeth, the surface of their enamel and dentin, becomes demineralized. So yes, you got to be really, really careful about your patients. And sometimes it's not even just teenagers, sometimes adults, they become, what do we call them? Bleachorexics. they become addicted to using this stuff. And even most professional products, we don't use any chemical stabilizers because we utilize refrigeration from the instant of manufacture till the instant it's received cold by dental offices, and then they put it in their refrigerator. So we don't use any chemical stabilizers. But we're the only company that does that. And so even professional products have stabilizers in them because you can only put a certain amount in there, because if you make it too stable, then it won't work when you put it in the mouth. It's still going to break down before it's used, you know, during transportation and storage. So now you've got the acid that's produced as it's breaking down. So even many professional products out there have a little bit of concern regarding that. But of course, we as dental professionals, we're kind of in control of how often we'll give our patients whitening gels and we'll counsel them. But, you know, with over-the-counter stuff, who's policing that? Nobody. So that's something that your listeners, anybody, hygienist or anyone else in the dental health industry, take what I just said to heart, because we're the people that get to talk about this stuff with not only teenagers, but the parents of teenagers. You know, letting them know, hey, don't let your kids do that. Using white strips, no problem. But abusing white strips, no, you got to watch out for that. And so now the other thing that you asked me about, the kiosks, you know, we in the health professions, whether it's medicine or dentistry or any other, you know, health-related organization, truthfulness and ethics is very important to us. Otherwise, we wouldn't even be in the field. Having people virtually lying to what we would consider patients, but the general public, it's something that really rubs all of us the wrong way. And so when these kiosks pop up and they're saying, oh, yeah, we're using the same gels that the dental offices are using, that's a lot of baloney. They are not. They can't, because they're not going to put on paint on dam. You really think that you're going to put a 25 to 40% hydrogen peroxide in someone's mouth in a kiosk without protecting the gums? Heck no, you can't do that. And you really think that the products that they're using are high-grade professional products? No, they're more like OTC products that are going to have the stabilizers in them, but also they will not have been protected nearly as much. They will have broken down. So what's really, really aggravating to me is that these kiosks, and I've stood in front of them and listened to the people in the kiosks making their sales pitch, and it's flat-out lies. I think that is my biggest pet peeve. If they're going to do it, You know, at least be honest. Hey, you know, what I'll do for you here in my chair is pretty much what you could do for yourself in 1 hour using an OTC product. So I wouldn't really have a problem. But they are totally misrepresenting themselves. So anyway, those are the two things that I wanted to get out regarding your last question.
No, that's great. Thank you. So do we have a defined age to start whitening?
This is a really, really good question. In fact, you and I talked about it a little bit before. Mm-hmm. There never was a particular recommended age. And there's a lot of, let me call it scuttlebutt, which basically I mean is a bunch of BS of people saying, oh, and sometimes key opinion leaders out there, well-known people saying, oh, you shouldn't whiten teeth until someone's 18 years old. And, you know, these are people that know nothing about the science. But here's the bottom line. There is absolutely no age contraindication as far as damage to the teeth or gums to whitening. And in fact, the leading university-based researcher in the world, by far, is Dr. Van Haywood. He's at one of the dental universities. And Dr. Haywood, in one of his lectures, I heard him say that there's no age contraindication whatsoever. And then he said, heck, you could even whiten the teeth of a five-year-old, but then why would you want to? So he was making a point. And then he went on to say that because of how well-known he is in the academic field, twice he has actually whitened the teeth of five-year-olds. And he said that he was not treating the five-year-olds in those cases. He was treating the parents, because five-year-olds, they don't care what color their teeth are. But when it comes to age, there is no contraindication as far as the pulp, as far as the teeth, as far as the gums. The concern is patient management. Until a certain age, you really cannot be sure that the children are doing what they're supposed to be doing. For instance, with a fluoride toothpaste, you have to be really careful until a certain age that the kids aren't swallowing that stuff. It's a lot more complicated doing whitening. So that's really, as far as young kids, my only concern. I will tell you that the younger teeth are, the more easily they whiten. And maybe at some point in time, a little bit later, we'll get into why. The older you get, the more difficult it is to whiten. Now, at about age 14, on average, everybody's different, you have enough eruption of adult teeth that you can start whitening. The interesting thing is, no, the teeth haven't erupted through the gingival tissues as much as they will have at age 18. But the interesting thing is that bleaching factors that whiten teeth, they not only go directly straight into teeth, but then they go laterally. So they will spread out in the enamel underneath the gingival margin. So as the teeth later on erupt, you're not going to see a yellow line there. So from my perspective, age 14 is the ideal age to whiten, because you will get the teeth so beautifully white, and then you'll be able to maintain that the rest of their lives. So that is the ideal age. Now, I published that in 2007. Now, prior to that, no one else had ever said that. Well, now, virtually every teeth whitening company that I know of has fallen in line, and they all now recommend age 14 as the most ideal age to whiten because of that. But, you know, there's something else that I'd like to talk about right now that comes to mind. Dr. Leonard Tao and I actually co-authored an article a few years ago about this. And I'll tell you the story. And then I'll tell you the story of my son. Lynn had a patient come in, and he did core whitening on her, and her teeth got brilliantly white. She was just thrilled. And so this is in Philadelphia. Now, her sister lives an hour and a half away from her. And so when she was visiting her sister, they were commenting on her teeth. Oh my God, your teeth look beautiful. Wow, what'd you do, et cetera. And then they started talking about her nephew, who was at the time 11 years old. Now, he had fluorosis, and he had pretty advanced fluorosis with significant brown spots. This kid was a very rambunctious kid. His name is Quentin. When he was younger than 11, nothing ever came up with his friends, because before age 11, children aren't very socially aware. But right around age 11, they all started noticing now his brown teeth. So they start teasing him. And one of the things they were doing is, you know, the color brown is the same color as our feces, right?
So
the kids were saying, what did you have for breakfast? Shit. You know, things like that. So anyway, he started hiding from the other kids at recesses and at lunch, and he stopped smiling, and his mother was frantic. She had taken him to some dentists who said, oh, yeah, he's age 11. There's nothing that we can do about that, you know, and gee, you know, you can't even whiten that. You know, we'd have to, you know, put veneers on it. We can't do that until he's, you know, 18 years old. Well, the kid was absolutely, had turned into a hermit. His entire personality changed. So the mother called Dr. Tao, and then he called me on the phone, and he described it. He says, hey, can we handle this? I said, absolutely, you can handle that. And I told him what to do. And he didn't even need to do any in-office whitening with that case. So when all was said and done, all of the dark was gone. His teeth were nice and bright white, and none of the brown was left. And the kid went back to being his old rambunctious self. And the funny thing is, Dr. Tao, and we show this in the article, took pictures of this young man when he first came in, and he had a dickens of a time getting the kid to smile, to show his teeth. The kid was trying to cover. Now the brown spots were in the incisal half of his upper anterior teeth. So when he would smile, he would try and raise his upper lip so you could see the cervical half and cover the incisal half with his bottom lip. Can you believe that? He had trained himself to do that. And so anyway, when all was said and done, and his teeth were white, Dr. Tao took a picture, and you could see the kid's face light up with the biggest smile you ever saw. The point is, studies have shown, and I did a lot of research on this, the studies have shown that when children, more so females than males, but males also, when they're young and they are teased about something cosmetic, whether it's being overweight or whether it's being too tall or too short or something about the smile or whatever, this causes permanent psychological problems for that patient throughout the rest of their life. The most common problem is eating disorders. The point I want to make is, why in the world will dentists say, oh, no, we can't fix this problem or that problem, whether it has to do with whitening or not. We can't fix that until they're age 18. They are sentencing that child to a life of psychological problems. The bottom line is, there's always something we can do, even if it's temporary. So in this case, at age 11, yeah, a lot of his permanent teeth hadn't erupted. So what? As they erupt, you'll make more whitening trays, and you'll continue whitening. I had congenitally dark teeth and a little bit of diffuse tetracycline staining. And probably many people out there have seen my before and afters. But I gave that gene to my son, Chad. And when Chad was 11 years old, he came to me and he said, Dad, you know, why are my teeth so dark? And I said, Chad, why are you asking me? And he said, well, some of the kids at school are asking me. And so I got upset. I said, are they teasing you? And he said, no, they're not teasing me. They're curious. And so that made Chad self-conscious. So what I did is I made him whitening trays, and he wore them for, I believe, 3 nights, and his teeth looked great. And then once every year or so, because he had a changing, you know, a mixed dentition, every year or so until he was about 14, I made him whitening trays to whiten the teeth, you know, the newly erupted teeth. So one of the things that I would say the vast majority of dental professionals worry about as far as whitening the teeth of a child is, oh, the pulp is large. Aren't we going to damage the pulp? Well, that's exactly the opposite of the science. The science shows that I don't care who you're whitening on, You know, unless the tooth has had a root canal, hydrogen peroxide, actual molecular hydrogen peroxide, is going to some degree, get into the pulp. And this could cause a problem because when it breaks down, it's going to break down to radicals, which could damage the tissue. But aha, the body is smart. The body has antioxidants that are in all of our tissues. Now, what's an antioxidant? When hydrogen peroxide breaks down to oxygen and water, it's not going to be harmful to our bodies. But when it breaks down to free radicals, that can be damaging, because remember that throughout our bodies, 24 hours a day, we're going through oxygen metabolism. And what's the end product? Hydrogen peroxide. Our own bodies, in every cell throughout our body, creates hydrogen peroxide that is equivalent to 100 times the amount of hydrogen peroxide that we would put in a whitening tray one time. So what happens to all that hydrogen peroxide? Well, we don't want it to break down to free radicals. The body doesn't want to, because it would kill us. So in the presence of an antioxidant, hydrogen peroxide is forced instantly to break down to only oxygen and water. We'll not allow it to break down to free radicals. So back to talking about hydrogen peroxide getting into the pulp. Well, we're really not concerned about that, because a catalase peroxide is there to break it down. And how strong is catalase? One molecule of catalase is capable of destroying several million molecules of hydrogen peroxide. Now, think of the pulp size. Which pulp is healthier? A 14-year-old large pulp or a 50-year-old narrow pulp? Well, of course, it's the younger pulp. It's much more vital. Mm-hmm. It has much more blood circulation. As we get older, not only does the pulp canal shrink, but it becomes much more fibrous. So the circulation, which of course everyone will agree is very important to health, the circulation of a 50-year-old pulp isn't even close to the circulation of a 14-year-old pulp. So the point being that the science shows that whitening is safe, but if you're going to talk about degrees of safeness, it's far more safe in a 14-year-old pulp than it is in a 50-year-old pulp. And that's something that people don't realize. So don't be afraid to whiten the teeth of even an 11-year-old if there's a reason to do it, if they're being teased, that type of thing. But normally you're going to start at age 14, because, you know, we as dental professionals, heck, we can make our kids whitening trays, but for a patient, they got to come in and pay for it every time. So age 14 is the ideal age to do that. And of course, the upper end, certainly with geriatric patients, there's no health contraindication whatsoever to whitening their teeth. But the problem is that, remember, as I said before, the older you get, the more difficult your teeth are to whiten. And so a lot of dentists tell me that, you know, previously with other whitening systems, trying to whiten the teeth of an 80-year-old was like beating their head against the wall. So I think that pretty much covers the, as far as from a safety standpoint, the age at which we can whiten.
There's a lot of people saying that peroxide is like, it can harm the tooth. Where do you think that came from? And how do we have that conversation with our patient that might be concerned about their enamel being damaged?
There's a lot of people out there, and many of them key opinion leaders, you know, famous names that write articles and lecture to us, things like that, that don't really themselves have a good understanding of the science. So let's talk about what can be hazardous. What can damage enamel? Well, pretty much there's two things. A hammer. You know, you hit a tooth with a hammer, it's going to break. That can damage enamel. Or acid. Can you think of anything else that's going to damage the enamel? That's pretty much it.
That sums it up, yeah.
The bottom line is, you know, as I mentioned, to whiten teeth, we must have the peroxide force it to break down the route of free radicals, because it's the perhydroxyl radical primarily that whitens teeth. But when that happens, we have no choice. It's also going to give off hydrogen ions. any of the companies out there that don't refrigerate their gels, they have to have some sort of stabilization. And phosphoric acid is one of the two most common types, and even more so the OTC. So to a degree, high quality professional whitening gels, if overused, if abused, could cause some damage. And certainly over the counter will cause much more damage. Although using over-the-counter white strips once or twice, I'm not worried about that. Typically, that's where the harm would come in. And in fact, this ties in very, very importantly with our core, our core whitening system. I was a consultant over a number of years to pretty much every large whitening company out there, and it really, really aggravated me that I would give them, based on science, I would give them recommendations of things they could do to make their system work better. But these corporate entities, you've heard the saying, what are the three most important things with real estate? Location, 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 right? Well, in the corporate world, it seems like, many of these corporations, what's the most important thing for a corporation? It's profit, profit, and profit. So where does effectiveness of your products come in? At least no sooner than number four. So that's one of the reasons why I allowed dentists to talk me into starting my own company and creating my own products. One of the things that I told all the other companies out there constantly was, you got to get rid of the chemical stabilizers and stabilize your gels using refrigeration instead, because that way you don't have to put any phosphoric acid in at all. Also, you won't have any breakdown before it's used, resulting in acid resulting from the breakdown of hydrogen peroxide. So by doing refrigeration, we're able to overcome that. And one of the other things that I've done is I've made it so that with all of our whitening, various whitening gels, I have created buffering systems. Because, when we put even our products on teeth, and one of the things, with ours, since there are no chemical stabilizers, when you take it out of the refrigerator and you put it on the warm teeth, and there are no chemical stabilizers, they're as unstable as you can get. And so the effectiveness is extreme, the effectiveness is in terms of whitening. But as they're going to break down on the teeth, they're going to form acid. I know that. And so I have also added buffering systems to virtually gobble up the hydrogen ions as they're produced. So that way, the breakdown doesn't result in it becoming more acidic throughout the process. And also remember, acid is a chemical stabilizer. That's why they put phosphoric acid in. So one of the common things is that when you put hydrogen peroxide, say for instance, on someone's tooth, and maybe you do it for 15 minutes or 20 minutes or whatever that particular brand says, as you go through, it's going to become less and less effective, because as it forms acid, it starts to stabilize. So the breakdown reduces. With ours, not having any acid and having a buffering system so it stays neutral, it is extremely effective throughout the whole thing. It doesn't slow down. But anyway, so that's the concern. Can peroxide be damaging? Yeah, it can. It can with misuse of over-the-counter products and even to a degree misuse of professional products. With ours, pretty much, kind of like Dr. Van Haywood said, why would you want to? I like to say you could whiten every day the rest of your life and you won't harm your teeth, but of course, why would you want to? So that's pretty much all the information on those rumors out there of peroxide being harmful.
So we have just a few more minutes left, and I'm wondering how quickly I can ask these three questions.
Okay.
So I'm sure they're probably a little bit more complicated, but I would love to know, if there's any contraindications that we did not cover, that for those people that should not be whitening, because one of the things that I remember learning way back in the day is like what not to do while you're whitening, trying not to drink the coffee and the wines and things like that, because you would actually stain the teeth more. And I'm curious if that is truth or myth. And I'm curious, the sensitivity and what we can do about that.
All right. Okay, so that's three different questions.
I know.
Let's start with the consuming of staining foods. There are two phases of activity of peroxide that whiten teeth. Then they occur simultaneously. One is called oxygenation, and the other one is a term I actually originally coined called conversion. Everybody listening here is probably familiar with the difference between extrinsic stain and intrinsic stain. Mm-hmm. Extrinsic is the stain that you get on the surface of your teeth that, for instance, a hygienist can clean off, but it starts soaking into the tooth structure and becomes intrinsic, and you can't clean that off. It's now within the tooth structure. The great thing about oxygenation is that the microscopic, what I call scrubbing bubbles of the oxygenation phase, they start getting into the tooth structure, breaking up the organic stain molecules that have gotten into the teeth and forcing them back out of the tooth via diffusion. So it's reversing that. So it's rejuvenating the cleanliness. Now, there's only a certain amount of that that the typical whitening can do. Our particular system, the trays that I invented, allow 6+ hours of whitening, active whitening during sleep instead of the typical 20 to 30 minutes of whitening that the other systems have out there because of their trays. So with all peroxide, you will have cleaned a certain number of microns at least into the enamel so that now the enamel is more porous. Now, I don't mean porous in a bad way. It's more porous like it was when the tooth first erupted into the mouth. So in other words, it's clean. So there's openness, microscopic openness, where you have removed the debris. So for instance, the interprismatic spaces within the enamel prisms, the intraprismatic spaces, the intercrystalline spaces, all this, these areas now are clean during and right after whitening. And you haven't had time for salivary proteins and other debris to pack into there, to kind of seal it again. So if you eat something that's very staining, yes, it could soak into the tooth. On the other hand, it's going to be within the first few microns of the surface of the tooth. So the next time you go to whiten, say you're whitening at night, and you eat blueberries that day, and you get a little bit of stain that night, first thing that's going to happen is, bam, that peroxide is going to break those apart and remove them. Just to be on the safe side, here's what I like to tell my patients. During whitening and about 2 weeks after, ideally, what I'd like to have you do is not eat or drink anything that if you were to get it on a white shirt or a white blouse, you'd say to yourself, oh, darn, that kind of stain doesn't come out. So I like to tell them to be a little bit careful. But in reality, it's more important after you're done with whitening. Because if you're in the midst of whitening, well, if you get a little staining now, first thing that's going to happen within the first probably 2 minutes of when you put those trays in that night is it's going to re-whiten it and then continue whitening from there. So I'm not concerned that much about that. But when you're done and you're not going to be whitening again, you want your patients to stay away from staining foods as much as possible. And also after whitening, it's not a bad idea to consider something like, you know, some of the remineralizing products and, you know, fluoride toothpaste, things like that, so that you get a little bit of remineralization on the surface of your tooth there. So that's that first question. Now, the second question you had was contraindications. And this is important. Now, of course, what everybody already knows is one of the contraindications is an existing veneer on an anterior tooth. Well, that's not going to whiten. So when the teeth whiten, now you're going to have a dark tooth where the veneer is. And that would fall under the category of patient management. How badly do you want to whiten your teeth? If you want, we can whiten the heck out of your teeth. And then when we're done, we'll put a new veneer on and match it. Okay, but the patient might say, oh, you mean I'd have to redo that veneer? Oh, no, I don't want to do that. So it's very important to have that discussion with your patients if they have any cosmetic restorations from second bicuspid forward. And then, of course, like you will read on every label of any kind of product in the world, any sensitivity to any particular ingredient. If you have someone that has an allergy to something or other that would be in a whitening gel or whatever, you know, that's a contraindication. Someone who is not just sensitive to temperature or, you know, having sensitive teeth, but sensitive to the extreme. And if they tell you they've tried to whiten their teeth before and they've had extreme sensitivity, it's not necessarily a contraindication for core whitening, because, you know, there's several things that we do to attack the sensitivity situation, but it's something you should think about and talk to the patient about. Now, probably one of the most important things that I'll say in this answer is tooth translucency. You know, a patient comes in and their teeth are kind of gray. Are they really gray? Maybe. Maybe the discoloration in them is gray. But maybe they have more translucency of their teeth, so the blackness of the inside of the mouth is showing through as a gray. Well, teeth whitening, I don't care whether it's core whitening or any other brand of whitening, it's not a miracle treatment. It will whiten teeth, but translucency has to do with tooth structure. You hear a lot of people talking about that, oh, if you over whiten your teeth, they'll turn blue. Well, you know what that is? That's people that have whitened to the extreme and they have translucent teeth, because you have that whiteness with the color of the tooth kind of showing through, creating a bluish kind of a tinge. So I developed what in our core whitening training, what we teach is something called the cotton roll test. And I suggest this be done on every single patient prior to diagnosing whitening. What you do is you have the patient open and you shine your dental chair light on the patient's teeth. And then you take a white cotton roll and you push it firmly against the lingual surface of the upper anteriors. So now, if you are looking at the color of the tooth and it looks a little bit gray with your light on it, with your dental light shining on it, and then you put the white cotton roll there and all of a sudden, boom, the tooth is much lighter. Hey, you've got translucent teeth, because what's happening is it got lighter because the light is going through the tooth, but instead of going into the darkness of the mouth, it's hitting the white cotton roll and reflecting back at you. All natural teeth are translucent to a degree. So when you do your cotton roll test, yes, I would expect that every single time when you put the white cotton roll behind it, it's going to lighten up just a little bit. But once you've done this several times, you'll learn the difference between a truly translucent tooth and a normal tooth. So with that patient, I then show them and I'll say, hey, most of the gray, if not all of the gray appearance, it's not color inside the tooth. It's because light is going through your tooth into the darkness of your mouth, and therefore it looks gray. It doesn't reflect light back at your eye. And so when I whiten your teeth, yes, the color of your tooth is going to get lighter, but what's going to happen is you are going to very likely, not immediately, but within a few days after whitening, you are going to see that area become gray, or maybe not as gray, but kind of a bluish gray a little bit. But then you ask the patient, what would you rather have? A dark gray and darker color of the rest of your tooth, or an overall lighter tooth? So you're going to have this condition no matter what. But would you rather have your teeth lighter or darker? And so that way, when they finish whitening, they can relax and be happy that their teeth look better. Also, when it comes to translucency, depending upon the occlusion, if you have the ability to, based on the occlusion, you can put a paper-thin layer on the lingual surface of composite opaque. Now, what's an opaque? Opaque is a composite material that is 100% opaque, and it comes in different colors. And you can get that made out of white, and you bond it to the lingual. Well, now, periodically, the patients, through eating and grinding and, you know, bruxism, you know, et cetera, will wear some of the areas off, and so it's a maintenance situation. But it basically is like holding a cotton roll in back of the teeth 24 hours a day. But that's, you know, something that you need to talk to your patient.
Yeah, that's fluorosis, a good suggestion.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it works really well. But, you know, this information is so important to be able to discuss with your patient. You know, manage expectations, the old term of deliver more than you promise, you know, that type of thing. The next one I'd like to talk about is fluorosis. Mm-hmm. Now, fluorosis, remember what fluorosis is all about. The excessive fluoride has an effect on the ameloblasts that actually grow enamel. You know, they call them the secretory ameloblasts because they secrete the chemicals that grow enamel. And fluoride will inhibit them. So you'll have millions, if not billions, of areas throughout the enamel where the crystalline hydroxyapatite has not formed, and you have an emptiness there. And if you have large areas, microscopically large areas, where the enamel has not grown, well, now when the teeth come in, erupt into the mouth very quickly, extrinsic stain will soak into those areas, and you'll start creating those brown spots. So in other words, when you're seeing fluorosis cases that are mottled white and brown, hey, that brown wasn't there when the teeth erupted. That brown happened after the teeth erupted. An unusually effective system like core whitening can get rid of all that brown because that's organic stain. Now, if the open cells are a little bit smaller, well, now the brown stains can't in mass get in there, so they don't turn brown. But because you have a virtually an open cell, light goes through the tooth and it hits the backside of that open cell and reflects back at your eye. And that's why these look white. So the white spots are actually more porous enamel. That's what they are. Now then, when you have even smaller areas, and of course it fills in with liquid, you know, with water basically from your saliva. When they're so small, just the water inside will allow light to go through. So you don't see those as white spots. But now you come along and you whiten. Well, number one, fluoride is inorganic. Tetracycline is inorganic. And that's why historically people have said, oh, you can't properly whiten fluorosis and you can't whiten tetracycline at all, because they're inorganic stains, so they're more difficult to whiten. And really, core whitening is the only whitening system out there that has shown the ability to, you know, whiten even tetracycline to amazing results. So with the fluorosis, the first challenge is the body color of the tooth, getting that lighter. But then you have the white spots. Well, here's what's going to happen. Those white spots being more porous, they're going to absorb the whitening gel bleaching factors really fast. So you know what's going to happen? The first things the patient's going to see is those white spots have gotten whiter. So now they're going to be freaked out. So you got to tell them ahead of time, this is what's going to happen. But you can't get whiter than white, true white. So they'll reach their maximum whiteness within a couple days. And then over the period of time of the full whitening regimen, the background color will come up. And with a really effective system like Core, you can get it so white that the contrast is minimal. But the important thing is you always tell your patients, hey, those white spots, that's structural. They look white because of this optical illusion of reflecting light back. And whitening attacks color. It can't fix the structure. So you are always going to have those white spots. Of course, there's ways to try and remineralize those, but that's a different topic. So you got to let the patients know, because if you don't tell them ahead of time, then they're going to be angry with you at the end. But if you explain that beforehand, then they can relax and be happy with the results. And the bottom line is that the contrast becomes minimal enough that people just don't notice. But now there's one more thing about that. Those little tiny areas that didn't show up as white spots, well, now the oxygenation of the peroxide is going to even clean those out. So now those areas are going to become white spots. So your patient's going to end up with even more white spots at the end of the day. But the bottom line is, the before and after, oh, there's no comparison. It's still a great result as long as you manage the patient's expectations and the patients understand that. Okay, so the next contraindication, or I would say concern, is tetracycline. Before core whitening, it was always said that you can't whiten tetracycline. But now you actually see a lot of companies out there claiming they whiten tetracycline where they never did before core whitening was created. And they do that just because we say it, so they're going to say it. Bottom line with tetracycline is that when it comes to whitening, the closer to the incisal edge that the band is, the tetracycline band, the more effective it's going to be, the whitening. The closer to the gingival margin the band is, the more likelihood you're still going to end up with some discoloration there. That's going to be far, far, far better than when you started. But again, under promise and over deliver to your patients. You want them to understand this. And you let them know that, hey, before core whitening, there's really no way to get these teeth white other than spending tens of thousands of dollars on 20 veneers. So you have the patient agree with you that any improvement is a miracle. And given that, you know, with our system, you're rarely going to get less than 80% improvement. You know, there might be cases out there to get 50%, but that's going to be rare. But even 50% improvement, oh my God, that's like a miracle for these people if that's what you lead them to expect. You know, if you just say, hey, I'm going to get your teeth white, and then they only get 50% better, now a lot of them are going to look at the glass as being half empty. So they're going to be upset with you. The final thing that I can think of is orthodontics. This is a big concern of mine because it happened to my son. Pretty much anybody who's been studying dentistry at all, they know that when you're prepping teeth for a restoration where you're going to use any bonding, you should be etching with approximately 37% phosphoric acid for about 15 seconds. And if you want to bond to the uncut surface, the virgin surface of a tooth, about 30 seconds. So we know, we've been told with studies in orthodontics, when they're bonding on brackets, that if you over etch, the bond strength actually is reduced. But you know what? In a practical sense, it's really meaningless. Rarely has any orthodontist ever seen that because of over etching, a bracket falls off. So they don't care. No one's ever told them about the potential other problems of over etching. So they turn this over to one of their assistants, and I saw the problem happen enough that I went to five different orthodontists in my area and asked if I could observe, and I videotaped or I videoed on my phone the banding process or the bracketing process. The best case scenario that I saw was etching for 2.5 minutes per tooth. The other ones averaged 5 minutes of etching per tooth. Well, now what happens is the etch caverns that get into the enamel are then filled with this unfilled bonding resin very deep into the enamel. Well, the studies have shown that without exception, every unfilled resin of any kind, including bonding agents, will positively darken with time. But of course, you know, composites, you know, the materials that we use, well, they're 99% filler. And with almost no resin, you know, just ultra thin resin holding everything together. So we don't have that problem with composites. But bonding agents, those are pure resin. What then happens after the debanding, whether it's immediately after someone has ortho and they want to now whiten their teeth, or whether it's 5 years or 20 years after, when you go to whiten, not only have those areas turned darker than the rest of the teeth, but they won't whiten. Because we've all heard that resins and porcelains don't whiten. And so what you end up with is very white teeth with brown bullseyes in the middle. And it is infuriating. When my son had his bracketing done, I went with him. And unbelievably excellent orthodontist. So his assistant, and I could walk you through it, but she ended up leaving the etch on way too long. And I was sitting there about 20 feet away reading one of my dental journals, and I'm thinking to myself, when's she going to finally rinse that stuff off? And at one point, she got up then to slowly walk away as if she was going to have some coffee. And I said, what are you doing? And I ran over there and I rinsed everything off. And the orthodontist came over. And he says, what's wrong? And I said, how long should you be putting etch on these teeth? And he said, 15 to 30 seconds. And I said, well, it'd be a darn good thing if you taught your assistant that. Well, anyway, my son's 36 now. So this is when he was what, 14, something like that. I went to whiten his teeth 10 years ago without thinking about it. And he ended up with brown bullseyes. He was so upset that since then he won't even talk to me about doing anything to his teeth, whitening his teeth, because now the tooth structure has now started to re-darken again. But anyway, this comes up so often. One that really was bothersome was it was a hygienist that called me furious, you know, thinking it was our fault. And it was her niece. And she's the one that did the whitening on her niece. And this happened. And I have pictures, and I have approached all of the dental journals out there, including the hygiene journals, told them about this, shown them my photographs and everything, and said, you know, we need to educate the orthodontists, because after talking to them, after I observed, et cetera, none of them knew this, and they said they wished they knew. None of them will let me publish an article on that because they don't want to offend orthodontists. Can you believe that?
Yes, I can, actually.
Can you believe that? So anyway, that's something that I always like to recommend, is if you have a patient that's had orthodontics, what you do a little test first. And right dead center in some of the anterior teeth, you put a little tiny dot of phosphoric acid. And you let it sit there for 30 seconds. Then rinse it off. If it's still shiny, then there could be resin deep in the tooth. So then put it on for another 30 seconds. If you don't see your typical etch pattern that you see after you normally etch a tooth, you have a problem. Now, how deep is that resin? We don't know. You know, at that point in time, you might want to consider disking the surfaces just a little bit. Mm-hmm. You know, with a rough disc at first, and then polish it. And I'm talking about taking just a little bit off and then redo the test. I don't have an absolute answer for this, but education is very important. And as long as we know that this can happen, at least everyone listening can be looking for that.
Right.
Because once it happens, it's devastating. It's really devastating. You asked me, what was the third one? Was it sensitivity? Do we have time to go into that?
I don't know if we have time to go into that, but do you have any quick thoughts on that?
I'll tell you what we do about the sensitivity at CORE, and that'll kind of also tell you what goes on in general out there. There's two causes of sensitivity. The one, everyone's heard of Branstrom's hydrodynamic mechanism theory, that basically says that when dental tubular fluid is pulled outward or pushed inward, it deforms the odontoblasts, which trigger the A delta nerves lining the pulp and cause pain. You know, that's your typical dental sensitivity. The other concern is that the oxygenation, which is good, that removes stains from within the teeth, hey, it also will remove smear plugs. So now you open up the tubular fluid. All whitening gels are hyperosmotic, without exception, including ours. So it will, through osmosis, pull on the dental tubular fluid to cause sensitivity. Now, when you use chemical accelerators or chemical stabilizers, you will raise the osmolarity of that gel as much as 11 times. So that's 11 times greater pull. So given that we use no chemical stabilizers, the pull of our gels is much, 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 much less. It can be 1/11th of the other ones. So that's number one. But the other thing is, after years of research, I brought out a desensitizer called CORE Complete Desensitizer a couple of years ago. that is just amazing that actually seals the tubules instantly. If you use that before and after whitening in the office, you now have resealed any tubules that were opened up during whitening, and all of our at-home kits include it, so that every morning when the patient takes the trays out of their mouth and brushes their teeth and flosses, then they apply the desensitizer on their own teeth to plug any tubules that were opened the night before. So because of that, we have a lot less sensitivity. That's how we have attacked it. There's a lot more information about what causes sensitivity, but I don't think we have time to go into that.
There's never enough time. So, but there is you do have a webinar coming up. I would love for you to tell us about that, and then where people could come or go to find more information from you and about CORE and find you or your other speaking events.
I have written several science papers. You're familiar with white papers?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I call ours science papers because that's what they are. They're pretty much white papers, but all based on science. So if your listeners would like to call CORE Whitening, any of our reps would be very happy to send them any of the white papers. And we have the full science of how of teeth whitening in general, the science of sensitivity, and specifically sensitivity as it applies to teeth whitening. Because, you know, just like General Patton read Rommel's book, we as dental professionals, the more we learn about the problem and why it occurs, the more we can help our patients. I also have a science paper on the myth of bleaching lights and especially all the benefits of refrigeration. So the phone number at CORE Whitening is area code 866-763-7753. Or you can go to corewhitening.com, and CORE is spelled K-O-R, so it's corewhitening.com, and you can find a lot of stuff on there. The webinar coming up is the science of whitening, and then later on we'll talk about in there about another webinar that will be on the science of sensitivity, including whitening sensitivity. So this one's on the full science of whitening that takes you from the ground up. After you're done watching it, you'll understand absolutely everything about the good and the bad parts about whitening and why everything happens. And that airs at 8 p.m. Eastern Time, 5 p.m. Pacific Time on March 19. And you get one CE credit. To sign up, it is https://...
We can put that in the show notes too. We'll
put the link in the show
notes. Yeah.
All right. That's good.
That way people don't have to write it down.
It's a long one. But I've done that webinar before for other people. And gosh, the emails I get afterwards are wonderful. Because, you know, as we talked about in the beginning, nobody. I mean, you know, the hygienist might say, well, gee, we don't get any training on whitening. Well, don't feel alone. Dentists graduating from dental school know nothing. As far as they know, all you do is slap some gel on the teeth and mysteriously they get white. And that's all they know. And, you know, many of the so-called whitening experts out there that think they're expert just because they've done it a lot will lecture on it without having any knowledge of the science. And so all they're doing is spouting, you know, how it all just mistakenly came about. So I highly recommend learning what it's all about, because remember the term doctor, for instance, for a dentist, when they have doctor in front of their name, pretty much that means you're not a technician. You know everything about the treatment that you are giving that patient because no two patients are alike. And how can you alter things and know how to inform patients if you don't know anything about the science of the treatment you're offering? That's something that has always bugged me. So I highly recommend watching that webinar.
Well, thank you. And we really do appreciate your time and all the knowledge that you have shared with us today. I definitely learned a lot, and I have a feeling I'm going to have to listen to this particular episode a few times to kind of soak it in. So I do appreciate all of this, and I hope all of our listeners do reach out to you and are able to sign up for your webinar. thank you again. We really appreciate you coming on.
You know what? Let me give you my email. I'll tell you what.
That'd be great.
Put my email address also in your notes or whatever, where you're going to put that link. I love getting emails, whether it's from patients or other health professionals out there. So anyone can feel free to shoot me an email and ask me any questions they'd like. So I'll give that to you also.
We will put all that information in the show notes, and everybody can also go to the show notes for their CE credit that they can take, because they can also get CE for listening to this podcast today. So thank you so much, Dr. Kersey. We really do appreciate this time and energy and all your information.
Okay. Well, this was a lot of fun for me.
Well, I know you guys learned a lot. I learned a lot. I'm still going to have to take some notes. Do you ever listen to these multiple times? Because even though like we're here for it, you know, I don't gather all of it because we, you know, we're dealing with like, what's the next question? How's the time looking? Are we having any audio issues? Mm-hmm. Like I'm not in it like I would be if I was listening and taking notes. And so I'm going to probably have to listen to that one or two more times.
Yeah, no, I mean, for sure. I know I wasn't in on this particular interview, but there are also other times when I listen back as either we're editing. We don't really edit anymore, but when we used to edit all the time, I'm like, oh, dang, that was so good. And then I want to share that with a friend. And then, go listen to the minute number 32.44.
So good.
Oh,
well, we hope you guys enjoyed it. Definitely reach out to Dr. Kersey, take his webinar that he mentioned. It is going to be in the show notes for you guys. And if you aren't already, follow us on Instagram, on Facebook, shoot us a message. You can do that in either of those platforms, or you can send us an email, which is just going to be atale2hygienist@gmail.com, or head on over to our website, subscribe to our newsletter, and that's just atale2hygienist.com. We like to make it nice and easy for you. Don't want to get all crazy, but yeah, you can find us at all of those places. And again, we would love your ratings and reviews. Don't forget to hit that subscribe button if this is the first time listening to the podcast, or maybe the second one. There's a subscribe button or a favorite button, depending on what kind of app you're working in. Do that. We'd appreciate it.
Yep, we would.
Well, we hope you guys have a great week. You get to apply some of this awesome new information that you learned today, and we will talk with you next week.
Bye, everyone.
Bye, y'all.